Friends the infamous Daytrip ticket to 10K. First gained global notoriety with Sheck West's viral hit, Mo Bamba. Recently, they produced a dance floor smash on Dua Lipa's Grammy-nominated sophomore album. A heartfelt country ballad with Mark Ronson and Miley Cyrus. And nearly half of Kid Cudi's long-awaited album, Man on the Moon 3, The Chosen. They earned their first number one single on the Hot 100 chart with the gothic Cudi and Travis Scott collaboration, The Scots. Took it straight from outside, straight to the couch. They also worked with Colombian artist Feed, who was nominated for a Latin Grammy for his album 19, and international stars like Flo-Yo, Santi, NSG, and AJ Tracy. Take a Daytrip is also known for shaping the sound of breakout star Lil Nas X, having produced hits like Panini. Don't you be a meanie, thought you wanted me to go, or why you trying to keep me teeny now? Rodeo, featuring Cardi B. And the current chart hit, Holiday. Hey, it's a holiday. They're currently executive producing his upcoming project. Let's give a huge virtual round of applause to Take a Daytrip. All right, welcome you guys. This is Take a Daytrip. We have David Biral and Denzel Baptiste, and we are incredibly excited to have you both here today and working with the talented kids of New York City's school system to give them some feedback on their songwriting and some support in terms of how to perhaps make their music a little more commercial, a little more artistic, whatever professional critique you can provide to help these kids is going to be awesome. So first of all, would you guys like to introduce yourselves?
Yeah, what's up guys? I'm David, what's up? My other half over there.
I'm Denzel.
And we're Take a Daytrip. Yeah, what's up guys?
Awesome. So, the first thing I'd like to ask you guys is the sonic tag, right, is so important, and I know that you guys have a terrific sonic tag. So can you break down, for the beat makers out there, because there's a lot of kids in the school system that are making beats. What is the importance of the sonic tag and how did you guys come up with that sonic tag?
Yeah, so we initially just kind of came up on the tag, and it happened over a period of like maybe 3 or 4 years, because we always, realized that, there's producers that don't have the tag that can be incredible, like Max Martin, but like the music industry is like, very aware of them, but people outside may not know them because they're not looking into it. So the tag is like, the one time in a song that the producer gets to, have a voice on the record. So it was always important to us. So the first time we had any iteration of a tag was our first session, I guess, as Daytrip. We were working with this artist named Rory, and we went to Atlanta to work with him, and we were just putting a bunch of sound effects in like the beginning of this song for some reason, and there was like footsteps, there was like a hay sound, there was a bunch of different things like a campfire, but the hay kind of stuck out to us. So that being our first placement, we were like, all right, well, maybe there's something in here that we can, make our signature and kind of copy this over to some of our other songs. So we picked the hay, which was just like something that we found, and we were using it for like a long time, and we had, we were like, all right, well, it doesn't say Daytrip, but it sounds cool. So we tried like a couple other iterations of, like different people saying Daytrip in different, accents and different tones and stuff. And then just naturally one day we're working with our friend Nestle, who was sending us beats to like work on, and he's a rapper, but he also produces. So he'll send us like a half, finished idea and ask us to finish it. So he came to New York after he sent like an idea that he was working on the flight. And we played it for him. He was like, wow, like Daytrip took it to 10. So we just used that. We were like, oh my God, you got to say this on this one song. And we did it, but we weren't really thinking like, oh, this is going to be a tag. This is just like a cool little intro for the song. And then we kind of put that together with the hey, and then it just became our tag.
Yeah, it's really cool. It's really cool. David, did you want to add anything else to that? Or?
Oh, no, just kind of laughing at it because it definitely was a random journey to us landing on that as our tag for the rest of our lives, potentially. So
yeah. Well, it's very distinctive. And, you know, what's cool about it is that it's very positive. It's like positive sounding, you know, like the tags are so important. Like, you know, DJ Khaled's tag is, you know, it is something humble about like we the best music as well. You know, like those types of tags are really important. So, you know, you guys out there that are watching, anybody who's interested in music production, you know, think of that, put some thought into that, because it's really like a sonic logo and it's an important part of your identity. Like Take a Daytrip just mentioned, especially if you're not out there at the forefront as the artist and you're contributing to the track, you know, your work is important as well. And it's terrific to be able to have that identity with it. So now you guys met at a dorm at New York University, right? So it's also my alma mater. Were you in a music production program there, or what, like, you know, were you doing liberal arts? What were you doing?
Yeah, so we were both in the Clive Davis School at NYU. Okay. So we both met our freshman year of 2011. So August of 2011 was when we first met. And yeah, we're in the same grade. We're, you know, both new kids to New York City, just, you know, trying to find our way around, and just happened to get to know each other like right during welcome week, and, you know, just kind of hit it off and became really good friends. So
that's excellent. I mean, you know, what's what I love about you guys is that you're, you know, with all due respect, you're like still kids, you know, like you're super young, and it's cool to see that kind of success like right out of the gate. You know, it's unusual. And now tell me a little bit about, you know, one of the things in your bio was, which I thought was interesting, was that when you first met, you kind of hit it off over musical genres. So tell me, can you speak to that a little bit? Like, because I did find that you guys really as well have a deep understanding of genres across quite a few different, you know, categories. So can you speak a little bit about that, and, you know, how that developed over the years for you, even when you were younger, maybe like when you're in school?
Yeah. Yeah. When me and Denzel first met, you know, we kind of had our own journeys coming out of high school where, you know, I was DJing when I was living in Vermont. Denzel had started producing when I think you were like 13 when you started producing, right, Denz?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Denzel learned how to play piano and drums in the church, where I learned how to play piano, classically trained, for, you know, since I was in first grade. So we came from two very different backgrounds. And a lot of the things that we were geeking out over, you know, when we were growing up in high school was a wide range of, you know, different things from all over the place. So when we met in college, we just started kind of comparing and, you know, throwing, you know, just things that we have loved at each other. And one of them that really stuck out to us the most was this electronic French band called Justice. And to this day, like a lot of Daytrip and just a lot of the things that, you know, we believe in terms of how we create, just a lot of the rules we follow, like so many of that is inspired by Justice. And I think the other one that we were probably inspired by the most as well was Nirvana, especially, you know, just some of the things that they were doing, like borrowing from classical music when it comes to chord progressions and all types of stuff. I think, you know, just me and Den just started geeking out, you know, a huge amount over a lot of that stuff. And then I guess from there, I was just kind of finding our way within, you know, the genres that we've worked in. And, you know, we get a kick out of really discovering music from other places and, you know, trying to put our own spin on it, or even collaborating with people from different places. So, and that's definitely a part of the essence of what Daytrip is just really exploring and, you know, being open to creation in all sorts of different genres and just having fun with it. So
Yeah, I mean, that comes across, you know, even with a song like Panini, where you guys go from a more urban, you know, drop in the verses to like opening up the drums a little bit with a little bit of a rock sound on the drums, you know, those little details, you know, take us all for a day trip, if you will. So no, it's again, your knowledge of genres is I think part of your strength, and your willingness to be open to exploring that stuff, you know, and kind of expanding the boundaries of what's possible, I think is one of your main strengths. And this past, it sounds like this past year you guys have really been on fire, right? With like, you know, from Weezer to Mark Ronson and Miley Cyrus, you know, as well as Lil Nas X. I mean, it's really, you have a lot to be proud of, a lot's going on. Can you talk a little bit about like how some of these things are happening for you guys? Are they organically, or how's this happening?
Yeah, I would say, you know, like the inception of Daytrip was really just an experiment in exploration in general. And, you know, the initial plan that we were going after was that, you know, David and I were in college, like our thesis project is that we're going to go to a different city every month and work with like the artists from that city that we could get in touch with and kind of make music based on our experiences there and like, you know, mixed with their experiences. So that's always been the, you know, the root purpose of Daytrip. And then like obviously like being in college, we went to like Boston and Miami, we ran out of money, so we had to like kind of fake it and just use the internet to travel around. So with that always being our goal, you know, that's always something we've been trying to, you know, step outside and learn new things and meet different people and take in their experiences and mix them with ours to make something new. So it, you know, at like right now it looks like, oh, we just at this point decided to do all these different things, but it's definitely been something that we've been working on for the past, you know, decade essentially since we met to really, you know, meet different people and step outside of our comfort zone to learn.
Yeah, awesome. So like, is that where that last quick question, the name Daytrip then kind of comes from, that idea of going to these different cities?
Yeah, it was really just a project. It was like our thesis project for NYU, like when we graduated.
Right.
It was just, you know, supposed to be like a one-time project where we're just going to do essentially that. And then, you know, as we were working on that project, we kind of learned that, okay, we could apply this concept to producing for other people. So that's what's brought us along that path. So it was kind of unintentional.
Yeah. And part of the reason why we called ourselves Daytrip too is, you know, after our trip to Miami, I guess it was sophomore year, spring break, and like Ultra Music Festival was happening, the Winter Music Conference was happening. So it was mostly like DJs that were performing. So me and Denzel kind of had this experience where we're just like, why are we like making beats like for other people and like nothing's happening? Like we should just start making music for ourselves. And just the whole thought process changed, you know, where we really just started creating the things that we wanted to create from our viewpoint. And when we sat down to start thinking about a name, you know, we started talking about the Miami trip and then just started talking more, you know, broadly of just where we want to be and where we want to go. And the thing that we always wanted to remind ourselves that we wanted to see the world through music. So by naming ourselves Take a Daytrip, like that was just always our constant reminder that like this is your goal, like this is why you make music together, and this is, you know, why you have fun doing this, is to live for experiences and see the world. So that was the one of the major reasons why we named ourselves Take a Daytrip too. So
yeah, excellent. I mean, it all makes sense. So, you know, we have some super talented kids here from around the Department of Education, New York City school system. And would you guys like to hear some music and maybe give some feedback to these guys?
Absolutely.
All right, cool. So we're going to start with Amanda Seeley. And she's from Wadley. And we're going to hear a song called I Can't Breathe. So give me 1 second. I'm going to cue this up. And we will share. Thank you.
can't breathe. I feel trapped in this world, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. Is it just me? Cause I can't breathe. I feel stuck in a cycle full of violence. We try to rise up, but they want us to be silent. Shooting us down, one by one. License and registration, and they pulling out a gun. Officer, please. My kid is in the car. They pull me out anyway and throw me on the floor. Knee up on my neck, what a terrible way to go. But I tell my kids I love them while I die slow. I can't breathe. I feel trapped in this world, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. Is it just me? Cause I can't breathe. Looking down at my family from up above. While they rioting and fighting, trying to show me love. Trying to fight for our rights, yeah, we wanna be free. Stop the white cops from doing racist things. I can't breathe. I feel trapped in this world, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. Is it just me? Cause I can't breathe. Tell us what we did to deserve this. Tell us why the y'all wanna hurt us. Tell us what it is, tell us what we did. Is it really just cause the color of our skin? I can't breathe. I feel trapped in this world, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. Is it just me? Cause I can't breathe.
Sick.
Love it.
Yeah. Yeah, for real. I see you tilting the camera back. Yeah, no, that was awesome. That was awesome. I mean, you know, I think the beautiful thing of music in the first place is, you know, being able to fully talk and fully, you know, share your voice on, you know, the things that are happening in the world. You know, it's something that especially, you know, people that look like us fully understand and fully feel, like, are feeling right now. So, you know, continuing to hear that message and, you know, obviously hear it from, you know, someone from all different age groups, you know, expressing this feeling, you know, it's that, you know, I mean, that's a song that definitely I felt 100%, you know, so, and that's the beautiful thing about music is just being able to express everything that's on your mind and, you know, express your opinions to the fullest. So, and hell yeah. I love it.
Absolutely. Yeah, it was great. I love that, you know, similar to what David was saying, that, you know, at any age you can really put your thoughts down. And I know Harold was saying this earlier, but like the intersection between, you know, like art and commerce and, you know, the art side is obviously you being able to express what you feel in your heart, and the commerce side is like, you know, it's a bop. And if you get both sides, like, you know, that's everything. So I feel like you know, you're well on your way to fulfilling both sides of that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amanda, do you have anything that you'd like to ask these guys, you know, related to that? I think what they're saying is like, you know, you're Grammy category, like meaning that you hit it from both sides, you know? So is there anything that you'd like to ask? I mean, these guys are here for you.
No, not really. Thank you.
All right. Terrific song.
Yeah. I want to ask, because I'm her teacher, and Amanda's in 11th grade, and she's been sitting in my classes since probably the 7th grade, because we're a 6 through 12 school. So we've, like, cultivated this over time. But this is the first time she's ever been willing to share her work, which is just, I'm like super proud of you, Amanda, for being here today and letting us, like, you know, share. But what can you do to encourage young voices, which, you know, like, I don't consider myself like a hip hop artist or anything like that, but I feel like I can help nurture talent, right? And young people like Amanda to be courageous enough to put themselves out there in real spaces. Like, Amanda, I know you're a very different writer than when you were like at 11 years old, but I have little recordings of your songs from when you were 11, you know, but this is like really, there's so much growth I see in you, and I want to encourage you. And I guess I want to just hear what these kind of pros have to say about how to like continue just doing this, because you're going to graduate next year and I'm going to miss you, but you must go on and keep doing this because you're really talented and it's wonderful.
Yeah. I mean, you know, first and foremost, you know, making music, especially truthful music, is, you know, one of the most vulnerable things that you can do as a human being, you know, and it takes a whole lot of courage to really speak your truth, you know, in this art form of music. It's, you know, it's not an easy thing to do. So, you know, first and foremost, you know, you showing us this song today, like, takes so much courage. You know, that's like step one. And that step is sometimes the hardest to climb over, is like fully showing your music and, you know, getting feedback and all that kind of stuff. I think the biggest thing is, like, you know, keep making the music that, you know, is you, is truthful to you. And over time, like, just get more comfortable and start, you know, getting a hold of the ground below you when it comes to putting the music out. And over time, things start to get a little more comfortable. You start to, you know, see fans that start coming, you know, more in your direction, or a little more, you know, showing their engagement towards you a little bit more, and, you know, all those kind of things, and just starting to interact with that. But it definitely is like it's a little journey. You know, me and Denz were now 27, and it definitely took us a while to even find the courage to put out, you know, our first things, you know, as musicians. But definitely the more and more you do it, and more you just say, you know, I'm just gonna break this barrier, and I'm just gonna, you know, keep putting things out and, you know, see where things go. It's a freeing experience, you know. But it's definitely something that takes some courage. And, you know, today is that's a huge step of courage right there, is being able to, you know, like, as you were saying, that you haven't you know, played your music that much. This is, you know, this is a big step. So I think just diving into that, getting used to it, continuing to make music and continuing to put stuff out, and then just start interacting with the people that, you know, are interacting with your music. And then you're just going to get nothing but better the more and more you put music out, and the more and more that you see feedback from people. So I think even just in general, like, progress happens from putting things out. And you start to see your music in a different way by putting things out, and different ways of yourself, of how to improve, how to get better. So if you're down to grow and you're down to expand, just keep putting the music out and, you know, see where the journey takes you. Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. Great. It's really great work, Amanda. Thank you so much for having the courage to participate today. And thank you, Denzel and David, for that great feedback, and Kim for, you know, nurturing her over the years. So next up we have Ian St. Germain hailing from Stuyvesant High School. And the name of the song is Tuscan. All right, so here we go. Tuscan from Ian St. Germain.
They say it won't last. Well, who knows? In love. see when I close my eyes. Close my eyes.
That was tight.
Sick.
Yeah, that was awesome. I really like the vibe of that track too. Like a whole lot. Yeah, that was beautiful.
Hell yeah, the man. Instrumentation, the chord progression, the time signature,
melodies fire. Too. Mm-hmm. I think that's probably one of the biggest things, especially as a vocalist. You know, being good at melodies and understanding, you know, how to write within the melody you put down. So yeah, that was great. Did you produce that as well, or?
Yeah, I have like an old mini Korg like in my basement studio, and I also have like this messed up Jaguar bass, but I did all the instrumentation.
Yeah, because the instrumental sounded really great too.
Thank you so much. That means the world to me. You guys are like two of my biggest idols, so you can't imagine how much that means.
Yeah, of course.
Can I ask you guys some questions? How many can I get away with? first thing I'd like to ask is, I had to actually make this song for my NYU application, but I feel as if for like a lot of the time when I don't have a deadline necessarily to make music, I kind of either get scared to do it or I give up too early. So like, how do you guys gain that like determination to finish projects?
That's really like the biggest part of our process, really, is just to, you know, everything that we do is kind of like, it captures this one specific moment in time, like what we're feeling at this moment. So it's really just like trying to get good enough so that you can put, you know, everything together in a quick enough time before your mind like goes somewhere else. So it's really like one of the most important things to us, that once we sit down and do something, we're like finishing it out, you know, to as far as it can go before we, you know, close the project or move on to something else. So even if it's not perfect, or, you know, 2 days later, you think of some more ideas, it's more about like, okay, now I know next time I approach this, you know, this process, like if I'm writing, I'm going to approach it differently this next time. But that, you know, last thing you did stays as like, okay, this is where I was at this point in time. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I also think having someone, you know, that you're close to, that's just always there to push you as well. I mean, and, you know, me, myself and Denzel's case, you know, obviously we collaborate together all the time. So for us, if I'm not pushing him, he's pushing me. You know, and it doesn't have to be someone you collaborate with. It could be really anyone. But I do think having some type of system or group of friends or just people around you that are just like, yo, man, like that song you started is really cool. Like, just, you know, take it to the extra 90% and then take it to 100%. You know, so for us, that's definitely been a big thing. You know, me just being able to sit there, and Denzel is always going to, you know, be pushing me and motivating me to finish something, and, you know, vice versa. Yeah. So any friends or people that you like to work with, you know, I definitely, recommend that, when it just comes to, some extra, push to get your work done. So, yeah.
Excellent. Well, lots of luck, Ian, on the, you know, on the application. I think that you have a great shot with that song, and you know, now you can say, that it's been blessed by Take a Day Trip. So, you know, what could be better?
Yeah, throw that in the application.
That's right. Yeah. Certainly can't hurt. All right, next up we have, thank you so much, Ian. Really great job. Next up we have Joseph Valentin from the Queens High School of Teaching. And the name of the song is called Back to You.
I went and reached the number of my phone. Even in your presence, I'm still alone. You're a different person and I'll always know. Why you come around when you want, but when I'm in need, I keep chasing you cause you have the lead. Yeah, I can find the strength in me to leave. Tell me, where did the love go? Tell me what I need to know. Communicate with me, we'll be alright. When'd you ever hit this low? Gotta recover from this blow. Or I'll end up having to say goodbye. Yeah. Oh, you got me running around like a track star. Manifesting every wish on the last star. Will bring me back to you. Got me begging for all these answers on a full moon. Cause you always think I'm in a bad mood. I want the universe to bring me back to you. To you. To you. I want the universe to bring me back to you. To you. I want the universe to bring me back to you.
Fire.
Yes, sir. Yeah, that was awesome. That was awesome. But your melodies are really awesome too.
Yeah, and your voice is crazy. I did not expect that. It kind of reminds me of like Nas X's tone. Like, his voice is so deep, you know, but like that characteristic, you know, once people hear it, it automatically kind of like makes your ears perk up, you know, like makes you pay attention. That's fire.
Yeah. Yeah, that was awesome. That was really awesome.
Thank you. Can I ask a couple, just one question?
Yeah, sure. Of course.
So for me, being versatile in music is really important to me because my favorite artists are like Ariana Grande, Mariah Carey, Nicki Minaj, etc. So you wouldn't, besides the Nicki part, you wouldn't really expect me to make a type of song more trappy, more like that. I'm very much pop bass, like pure pop mainly. But how do you, because I did my research a little bit, I saw you've worked with like Dua Lipa, Miley Cyrus, as well as a couple of rappers, Travis Scott, et cetera. How do you go about doing different types of genres while also kind of being authentic to you? Cause I do, you know, this song is important to me and it's like me, but I felt like I did stray away from my type of style to do something different, if that makes sense. So how do you like stay true to yourself while being different at the same time?
Yeah, I would say, like, you know, especially in your case, like literally whatever you decide to make is going to be you because it's your voice. Like, you make it, it's really easy when you're the artist because, you know, your voice is always going to, you know, be your voice. But I think, you know, having the intention to, it's really like, you know, it comes down to intention sometimes. Like, if your intent is to do different things because you love different things, then I think that naturally comes across. When it's sometimes like, oh, I'm going to do this, you know, because I'm going to do a Latin song because I want to like get the Latin market. I'm going to do a trap song so I get the trap market, without really loving those things and kind of being, you know, honest about like your intention with it, that's where it starts to get weird. But I feel like, you know, when you're going after things that you actually enjoy, like if you enjoy, you know, that kind of like 808 stuff and like those hi-hats that were on there and you enjoy it, like it's always going to sound natural because I feel like that's always going to come across.
Yeah, I think no matter the canvas, as long as you know you bring yourself to paint, like it's really just it's you at the end of the day, no matter what the genre is, like as long as it's you're just expressing yourself on whatever it may be, then that's your sound, you know. I think like for me and Denzel, you know, super early on when we were just starting to work together, just starting to make beats together, for a long time we were just trying to figure out some, you know, we're just figuring out what our go-to sounds are, like making our own drum packs, you know, go-to synth sounds, all that kind of stuff. And, you know, eventually we ended up landing on, you know, a lot of analog gear and a lot of synth keyboards and, you know, going back to a lot of the same drum sounds, no matter the genre. So I don't know if you produced that record, but, you know, especially from the vocal side, it's just, you know, bringing what is you to a record every single time, you know, like there's obviously so many artists in this world that can go across different genres. And whenever you listen to an artist on a trap record or a super pop, like Young Thug being one of them, like Young Thug is always doing his thing across, you know, every single genre that he's operating on. So yeah, I think vocalist, producer is just finding your sound and, you know, finding how you express yourself, you know, across what's laid out in front of you. It doesn't really matter the genre. So yeah, just be yourself, you know, and enjoy your art and live within your art. So yeah.
Sounds like good advice. So thank you. I mean, again, these are incredible tunes. And next up, we have another student from Stuyvesant High School. This is Isabella Lee. And this is her song, To the Moon. To the Moon. Just one second.
I tore my sleeve, trying to get you back to sleep, but all I remembered was I didn't catch you the morning of. Now coffee takes your place, but your memory lives in my headspace, flashing in the windows of the one you used to wait at the train stop, keep you closer when the temp drops. But I can't see now. You're jumping out of taxis with an empty place in the backseat. Took a week or two to forget me. I don't even think you're worth my love, but what is keeping you? It hurts so much. To the moon passing over, pour it up, overflowing, but it's not enough. I hate to be naive, but you echoing the lonely streets. To the moon passing over, please don't leave. Oh, please don't leave.
Wow.
Wow, that was amazing.
Yeah, that was awesome. Your voice is amazing. That was
thank you so much.
Yeah, of course.
The arrangement, like the harmonies and everything were sick.
Thank you. I wrote the full song, but I was working on it a few days before the deadline, and then I scrapped it all, which is something I want to ask a question about to y'all. But the day it was due, I did not sleep at all. So I was like manic, and I was just like layering vocals. And at that time I was like, this sounds sick. Like this is so good. Like, well, this is amazing. And then the next day I wake up and I listen to it again, and just like, it's out of sync. And I'm just like, bro, like where did this harmony come from? I don't remember putting that there. So yeah. Like, how do you, like, whenever you guys like put out a song, I'm sure like you spend a lot of time perfecting it, but one, how do you know that it's ready? And two, whenever you release it, like, do you ever catch mistakes in your songs and you're like, you know?
Yeah. But I mean, mistakes are the best part sometimes, you know, like, there's so many happy accidents, and like the mistakes kind of make it you, like to the, you know, like what we were talking about before of like, you know, what Joseph was saying, going after different genres and doing different things. Like sometimes when you make a mistake, that's what makes it characteristic to you specifically. And then you'll, you know, it goes crazy and then people start copying your mistake, you know? So I wouldn't like stray away from like even allowing yourself to make mistakes. But I don't know, sound fire to me.
Yeah, it sounded really good. Sounded really, really good. Yeah, but I do think, you know, any mistakes really, you know, add character to a lot of records, you know? I mean, me and Denzel wouldn't be here without mistakes because his laptop froze in the middle of when we were recording Mo Bamba, and the part with all the explicit words was really just Sheck West being pissed off about the record ending and then the beat came back, you know? So mistakes are sometimes the magic moment to a song. That being said as well, you know, when there's times me and Denzel spend months working on records. And that's just also part of the process as well. Like sometimes we do want to get a record as perfect as possible, depending what the song is, you know, and something like Mo Bamba, for that one, it made sense to make it in 30 minutes and put it out the next day. And something like this Nas project and, you know, the Cudi project, a lot of those songs didn't happen just overnight. And really takes like, you know, making something, going to sleep, waking up the next morning, realizing, oh, okay, like I could change this thing around or change that thing around, maybe, you know, get some feedback from someone you trust, fixing those things. And, you know, it's all part of the process, all part of the journey. Sometimes some of those things that you fix, you might end up going back to demo one after, you know, like I think Thriller went back to mix two after like 100 mixes of the song. So I don't really think there's any, there's no real advice on like what perfect is. It's just like what sounds perfect to you. And sometimes you might work all the way to demo 100 and end up on mix two, like, and it ends up being Thriller, and that's perfectly fine, you know? But go through the journey, like have fun with it. And when you wake up in the morning and you hear something wrong, like that's normal. Me and Denz, that happens to us every single day. So, you know, just go in and fix the things that are bothering you. And, you know, sometimes you add back some of the things for the character. So it's a journey. So, and it doesn't, finishing a song doesn't happen overnight, and it's not the same journey on every single song either. So it's always going to be different. Yeah.
Thank you guys so much. That was so insightful. I also have a lot of trouble like producing. So as you could probably tell, I'm not the producer. I don't have the producing, what's that word? Yeah, I don't have the skills like that Ian does or most people in here. So.
Well, did you put that together?
I did, but most of it was just vocals.
I would beg to differ with you, honestly. I mean, it was a really nice arrangement and it was produced just fine for what you're doing. I mean, I would keep doing that yourself and keep developing that because it was, you know, the harmonies and everything, it gelled together and it worked. So, yeah. You know, the more that you do that, the better you'll understand for yourself, like when you feel like it's done, you know, you just have to keep doing it.
Yeah. And so some songs don't need, you know, drums and all that kind of stuff, you know, like 4 out of 5 of Ed Sheeran's biggest songs are all ballads with just guitar, you know? So I think, you produce a record to what makes sense for the record. So you like the record that you just presented, how you presented it made sense. So you did produce that record, you know? So I think at the end of the day, if there's something that you want to learn, me and Denzel just go down like a YouTube rabbit hole a lot of the time. YouTube is one of our biggest friends and our biggest teachers. But yeah, if there's anything that you ever want to learn, I think just spend some time trying to learn from others and like perfect it. But at the end of the day, like when, you know, you're presenting a record that you did play guitar on or you did produce, like you are a part of the production process. And it doesn't matter if it has, you know, a million snares or, you know, no snares. You know, sometimes you just got to be Ed Sheeran and make 4 ballads and they're some of your biggest songs. So whatever makes and feels right to you, I think is the way to go, you know?
So just like feel it out.
Yeah. And of course, you know, song by song, everything's different. And I think if there's things that you want to learn, it's a good challenge, you know, to to sometimes step outside the box and try to learn from someone else and try to perfect it or put your own spin on it. But yeah, it's just a journey. Me and Denz, when we're working in different genres, like, we always have to kind of study and learn from others before we even attempt it. And you know, me and Denzel just happened to have put our 10,000 hours in, but you know, it's we still have a lot more to go, and you know, some places as well when it comes to working in different genres we're not even close to, you know, experts in. So really when we want to learn something, we just, you know, listen to music, we watch YouTube, like, we learn from others and then try our own spin on it and, you know, see how far we get. So, and just keep doing it. That's the biggest right. thing.
And I will say it is important for, like, all people involved in music, whether it's, you know, producers, writers, artists, even managers and A&Rs, to have, like, a understanding of, you know, like, production and, like, engineering and all these different aspects, because even if you're not the, you know, even if there is another producer, it allows you to communicate better what you want to hear to, you know, that person. So I feel like that is, you know, it's super important to, you know, watch some tutorials and try to do it yourself. And then, you know, next time when you're in with someone else, it's like, oh yeah, like, you know, bring that snare down 5 dB, like, cut, you know, the lows out to 40 Hertz, you know, kind of allows you to communicate better.
Yeah. YouTube is your friend. YouTube is your friend.
Of course. And TikTok too. I see so many producing videos on my For You page. It's very helpful.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you again, Isabella. Incredible. The last student that we're going to hear from today is Chris Leto, hailing from the Renaissance High School for Musical Theater and Technology. And this song is called In My DMs.
Cause you are in my DMs. Oh baby, let's make amends. Yeah, cause you are in my DMs. Oh baby, this is the end. So now you're being petty on your phone and you're home alone, so you feel alone. Tell me, do you really wanna fall in love with me? Talk to me, baby, you should talk to me and walk with me. Baby, you should talk to me, cause I just feel alone and you've been trying to hit me up. Yeah. How you gonna take my heart and give it back with lies? Like, baby girl, I really thought we had it, but now I guess our love is really past tense. Alright, tell me baby, is it alright? Tell me when you keep it in my lineup. Tell me baby, is it alright? So now you're being petty on your phone and you're home alone, so you feel alone. Tell me baby, do you wanna fall in love with me? Talk to me, baby, you should talk to me and walk with me, baby, you should talk to me. Cause I just feel alone and you've been trying to hit me up.
Fire.
Yeah, that's sick.
That was hard.
Yeah, super fire. That was hot.
Yeah, I love, like, the cadences and the melodies. Like, that was sick. Did you, like, write and produce that?
First of all, thank you so much. And it's an honor to be here. You guys are amazing. Honestly, I mixed and mastered the song. I kind of had a little, you know, like a little trouble, like, sending it in, because it gave a lot of megabytes. You know, I had it on waveform and I had to, like, you know, compress it down to MP3. So, you know, I lost kind of quality. To answer your question, I didn't produce the song. Shout out to my boy Skimmers. He produced the song for me. But I did mix and master, like, everything. You know, I've been, especially now, you know, last year, I got my equipment for pretty much everything. And it's been a challenge. It's been a challenge, you know. David said, every song is different. But, you know, as you go on, you start to, like, feel better about the little mistakes. And, you know, I guess it was definitely a challenge to this song. I feel like I did all right for, you know, the time being. And it was actually very funny because I was playing Call of Duty when I was making this song. I was playing Search and Destroy and I was with my friends. And literally, like, my friends hate this. I get on the mic and as soon as I have an idea, I either write it down or I record it. So, you know, I take my mic and I start recording. I go to Logic and I start recording. And I was the last guy left. So the guys were like, this man is really recording. Like, dude, on your left. You know what I mean? Like, everybody, like, it's just... So people kind of love that, you know, that I just record anything that comes to my mind. But I am definitely grateful to be here. And I appreciate you guys, honestly. Yeah.
Yeah, the song sounds sick.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, it's really dope. I even think, you know, you just explaining your process, you know, that's I think it's definitely a huge like, it's definitely a strong suit to be able to just come up with ideas just like that. You know, whenever we're in the room with people, especially writers or artists that, you know, work super fast, it just makes the job easier for everyone, you know. being able to throw ideas at the wall, bounce them back and forth, put them down quickly. So, you know, that's a huge talent in itself.
Thank you so much.
You know, that definitely came across on the record for sure. Your melodies are really dope too. Like, just the way you were floating on the record was really good. So, yeah, man.
Thank you so much. You know, it was definitely a challenge. I'm working on my my record, on my new album, Overwhelmed, and you know, I'm trying to get out there in the sense of my melodies, you know, and my and genres. You know, I am Hispanic. I am Dominican. So, like, a lot of people, you know, now, especially nowadays, a lot of people criticize either your accent or the way you maneuver your way into just your flows and the beat. And, you know, I appreciate you saying that about, you know, the way everything came together. It, like I said, it was definitely a challenge, but I'm glad it turned out the way it did. You know,
That's interesting. I've been doing a bunch of research on, like, you know, the intersection between, like, Latin music and, like, the new generation of, like, Afrobeats, which it sounds like, you know, and, like, we're like, okay, there's so much overlap, and, like, culturally there isn't really overlap, but musically there's, like, a crazy amount of overlap. So it's interesting to see, you know, you being Dominican and that track having so much like Afrobeats influence, but then the flow of it is, like, you know, somewhere in between or, like, something new but still, like, New York in a way. It's, like, really interesting to see that all, like, come together. So it's definitely keep, you know, exploring and you know, putting different things together in interesting ways, because sometimes it's like, you know, like, most things already exist, right? There's, like, only 12 notes and it's, you know, there's, like, you know, 12 notes, and then there's already these genres, like, defined almost. So sometimes it's, like, the intersection between, you know, different things that inspire you that make something new. It could just be, like, the fact that you're the first one to think of combining it in that way that makes it really, you know, go crazy.
Thank you so much, man. That means a lot. That means a lot. Thank you.
Yeah, man. Just keep doing it how you do it, end of the day.
Yeah. You know, I did relate to what you said about, you know, the mistakes, and just, I would say that I'm near a perfectionist. I want, especially when I'm mixing, like, if I hear some clipping or if I hear something, I need it to be perfect. But, like, I've grown, like, along the way to, like, appreciate those mistakes. Like, I always like, I listen to something, oh, the reverb is probably too high, or I probably said something wrong, or I messed up the lyrics or something, or this hi-hat is too loud. Sometimes I just leave some of these mistakes in, you know, just to give it a little bit more, you know, just make it unique. And so like, I relate to that a lot, you know, but yeah, I appreciate you guys so much. Thank you so much for listening. It's an honor, like I said.
Of course.
Thank you for sharing.
Yeah, of course. Absolutely.
Yeah, it's a great song. Thank you again. And thank you, you know, everybody for participating. Those are really terrific songs and excellent feedback from David and Denzel. Next up, I have a short video to celebrate Black History Month. It is Black History Month, so I thought that would be appropriate. And I'm going to cue this up and play this next. In honor of Black History Month, I would like to talk about the contribution of Black musical culture to the musical genres of New York City. I teach a popular class on the musical genres of New York City at Stuyvesant High School. We trace the history of New York City musical genres in the 20th century, beginning with the Harlem Renaissance and finishing up with the birth of hip-hop in the late 1970s. In between, we check out Tin Pan Alley songcraft, the influence of Atlantic Records' unique style of early R&B, Spanish Harlem's influence on the popular music of the 1960s, and the social and economic circumstances out of which disco was born. I tell my students at every stage of our journey through the genres of New York City that pop music as we know it would simply not exist without the enormous contribution of Black musical culture. American popular music is a happy amalgam of Western harmony, Western instrument technology, and Black musical innovation. The most important rhythm in pop, rock, R&B, and hip-hop is, hands down, the tresillo, a simplified version of the habanero. Harlem Renaissance-era piano player Jelly Roll Morton called this rhythm the Spanish tinge. In reality, the tresillo is really a rhythm that came straight out of Africa and became associated with Spain and its various colonies through the Atlantic slave trade. The rhythm forms the foundation of early rock and roll music and can easily be identified as a core rhythmic element in most every popular musical genre of today. Beginning with the blues and ragtime, the music of the Harlem Renaissance quickly evolved into a new subgenre of jazz called bebop. One of bebop's founders was Thelonious Monk, who had a highly unique percussive and improvisational style of playing the piano. Now I have to tell you, Stuyvesant High School students are known to be smart, but some amazing musicians have also attended Stuyvesant. That's right, Thelonious Monk attended Stuyvesant High School in the early 1930s. And if you ever visit the school, you can even see his report card hanging in the hallway outside the auditorium. In the 1970s, dancing took on a new level of style and self-expression in the form of disco, which came out of the LGBTQ scenes in Philly and NYC's Greenwich Village. While a diverse array of cultures contributed to the rise of disco, I have to give a shout out to another incredible Black musician from the disco era and beyond, who attended Stuyvesant High School. His song Good Times with his band Chic became the beat of one of hip-hop's earliest hits, Rapper's Delight. Of course, I'm speaking of none other than the current chairman of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, Nile Rodgers. Of Stuyvesant High School, Nile Rodgers fondly recalls, and I quote, "I wasn't enrolled. I just sat in on classes with teachers I found interesting." Well, if you're watching this, Nile, I hope you would have wanted to sit in on my class, because, in the words of the current generation, it's goated. All right. So, thank you for you know, being a part of this terrific master session on, you know, not only celebrating these terrific artists and students from New York City, but celebrating Black History Month, you know, and putting that the best, you know, energy forward in that area. You know, we're so grateful for what you guys are doing. Technically, we're at time, and I want to be respectful of everybody's time. So is there anything else that you guys would like to share?
Ooh, Denz, what do you think?
I don't know. There was a Q&A, right?
Well, again, I want to be respectful of your time. If you want to take a couple minutes and, you know, we could have a few minutes of questions from the student songwriters. Would you guys be up for that? All right.
Yeah, sure.
Let's do it. Let's do it. So, guys, we have an open forum here. So unmute yourselves and please ask a couple questions. Ian, go ahead.
Can I just ask, are you guys still in touch with Rockstar Peso? Because he was my next door neighbor like my entire life. And I remember hearing the song you guys did together first, and that's what first put me on to you. And I also want to just shout out that song you did, Die, goes so hard. And I was listening again today, and it's just incredible. Like, I really love everything you guys do.
Yeah, Peso's the homie.
That's he moved awesome. Out to LA recently. Have you seen him?
Nah, not yet, but I do know that he moved out here. I was just talking to him the other day.
That's crazy. Yeah. It's such a small world. It's insane.
Yeah. Yeah, Peso's a great guy. Shout out Rockstar Peso.
Peso.
Chris?
Hi. So I feel like a lot of students are, or just young artists, are definitely going to relate to this question. So as a young, upcoming independent artist, it is definitely the hardest thing. Like, it's just to like make people hear your music or just like to be heard. So I guess what I'm trying to ask is, like, is there any advice to any of those young up and coming artists, you know, on how to like maneuver your way into the industry or just make it, you know? Because I feel like we're all struggling when it comes to that, you know, like it's always, this is going to take it out. Like, you know, my songs, for example, like, or let's say I have a friend and he makes a certain song. I always tell him, bro, this is going to get you out of the hood, bro. We making it with this one, you know, and like, it's always, I guess it's always luck, but you know, any advice for those hard workers or just young independent artists in general, you know, a lot of us are trying to make it. A lot of us are really trying our hardest to, you know, either get a deal or just, like I said, maneuver our way into the music industry.
Right. You know? I mean, I feel like that's like the ultimate question with anything related to art, right? Like, how do you get it from your mind to a group of people, to a larger group of people, to like an even larger group of people? But I feel like this, my manager gave me this book to read about how groups form. And this was like a few years ago. And then when Lil Nas X came along, I was like, wow, like he's fully embodying this thought process of, it's not like, okay, you're going to take this song and you want everyone in the world to hear it, you know, tomorrow. It's really about like, okay, I have this song or I have this like movement that I'm starting. Like, how can I have a group around myself or find a group of people that would be interested in this? And then that group of people shares it to like the next group of people. And like the way Nas X did that, interestingly, and I feel like he's like the best right now at doing that. But it's like, okay, you find like a small community or you have a small community, like his was like a virtual community of like people on Twitter. And you know, you become part of that community, learn what they like, you know, kind of study what's going on, and then you put something out into there, and then it grows out into like bigger communities. But like, even for drill, it's like, okay, drill is, you know, more recently it was like really big in the UK, and it's like only people in the UK are really into it. Right. And then like Pop Smoke and like people in New York hear it. Now it grows to like, now it's, you know, the hoods of UK and the hoods of New York, then it grows to even bigger. And now it's like kind of like a worldwide thing. But I feel like, you know, it's really about, you know, finding a community that you want to really make a stamp in. And it could be, you know, your street or your school or your area, as small as, you know, it needs to be. But, you know, that's kind of how it starts.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, at the end of the day, you want the attention to come to you, right? And really the only way to do that is by putting music into the world or putting something into the world. You know, the less shots you take on goal, and you know, the longer you stay quiet, the less attention comes your way. And whether you're working a song that's out or recording new stuff to, you know, keep putting out, you know, in the case of Lil Nas X, he put out Old Town Road and just kept promoting that. In the case of, you know, Russ used to put out a song every single week, literally just four times every single month, new song, new song, new song. A couple of them, you know, didn't do anything. A couple of them really, you know, blew up. And then he started to build a community and build a fan base through that. So I think the biggest thing is just, you know, especially at the beginning, is just finding the confidence and, you know, keeping the confidence up to just keep putting things out and for the world to digest it. And if you're wondering how to get into the music industry or be discovered, like, it really just comes down to people being able to come across your work in the first place. You know, there's so many times where me and Denzel will get DMs or, you know, messages from people that are like, oh, like, I'm an artist, da 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 da, et cetera, but they don't send anything. So there's nothing for us to check out, you know? So if there is nothing to check out, then there's nothing that we can offer, you know? So I think the biggest thing at the end of the day is always just put your music out, let the people discover your music, and the people will come, you know? If it's good and you're putting out quality work, you know, in the case of Russ, like, he was putting out quality work every single week, just kept his head down, was putting stuff out every single week, and it worked out. But yeah, like, putting your stuff out and just keeping consistent at that, I think is step one to people discovering, especially people in the music industry discovering, and reaching out and, you know, giving opportunities and giving chances. So yeah, create your own story and, you know, run with it and keep it consistent. That's definitely a big thing.
Yeah. And
I was just gonna add one more thing. I think in this day and age too, you know, comparing Russ and Lil Nas X, you know, like, Nas put out one song and created a whole marketing campaign around it. In the case of Russ, he was putting out multiple songs. So also just what works for you end of the day, whether it's, you know, consistently making music and putting it out, or getting behind one song and, you know, pushing that. But just, you know, keeping the foot on the gas and, you know, just keep it going, and people will start to reach out, you know, if it's good and you're putting yourself out there, people will reach out. So, yeah.
Yeah. Good advice. I mean, what I was going to say is, you know,
thank you so much.
Have a great work ethic, you know, because it comes down to that. Just keep focusing on what you love about what you're doing, you know, because it's that love and that joy, that you connect with, that other people are then going to connect with, you know? So just make sure that you're really focused on what you enjoy as well, you know. Any other student questions? Any other questions that you guys would like to ask? Ian, you have another one?
Sorry, I wish I could pick you guys' brains forever, but I'll leave you alone in a second. I think I'm stuck between asking you two questions, but I think I'd much rather find out about how you guys developed your work ethic over time. Because for me, I feel like that's always my biggest issue, because it feels as if I have periods where I'm super inspired and I'm constantly working and nothing's going to stop me. And then I kind of go into phases where I really want to be creating music and I really want to be working with people, but for some reason nothing's clicking and I kind of fall back for a bit. So how do you continue to press on even when you're not necessarily feeling super inspired?
For us, it's definitely a factor of it is kind of twofold. One side is that we really do treat music like it's, you know, a job, even though it's extremely fun for us, and we would do it even if we didn't make any money from it. But we you know, we wake up early in the morning, we go to the studio, pretty much usually it's 5 days a week, but now because of the Nas album, it's 7 days a week. But we'll go in 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, and we stay, you know, to a pretty normal time. Then we get a good night's sleep. You know, we eat good food. We live a balanced life. And it's, you know, we're able to work for, you know, 8 months straight without having to be oh, I'm you know, I'm burnt out or something. And then the second half of it is having a person that's there to bounce ideas off. There's this company, Y Combinator, that, you know, if you have a startup, they're the, you know, the ones to go to help you build your company out, and like Dropbox started through going through Y Combinator and all these different giant companies. But their main prerequisite for being a part of it is that you can't be a solo founder. You always have to have at least one other partner, because, you know, when I'm like feeling a little tired and I would maybe rather like take a nap or go home or something, David might be like, oh, I have this idea, blah, blah, blah. Like, let's do this. Like, I just thought of this crazy thing. And then I'm like, oh, wow. Yeah, that'd be crazy. Now I'm like completely like involved in whatever we're talking about, and like, you know, vice versa. If he's not feeling it, I'm like, oh, let's do this. Then, you know, we automatically get pulled in together to doing things. So the gaps between, you know, times of inspiration kind of dissipate, because there's, you know, always a balance between people. So, you know, finding a good collaborator, whether it's like, you know, a great engineer or a great producer or another, you know, artist that you want to work with frequently, but definitely having a person to balance your energy off of definitely helps that work ethic.
Yeah. And, you know, with that being said, obviously, you know, me and Denzel don't have like a math test coming up or a history test coming up. Like, we're not in that phase in our lives anymore. So when we were in school, you know, you definitely, it's a different schedule. You got to balance, you know, the obligations that you have to, you know, turning in assignments and studying for tests and all that kind of stuff. So it definitely is a little different. And when me and Denzel were in school, even going to school for music, we still had to figure out how to balance that. But I think, you know, the biggest thing first and foremost is you are interested in music. You want to pursue music. And with that want, you always find a way around the things that you have in front of you, you know? And obviously, like, you know, me and Denzel graduated, like we stuck to our schoolwork. We think school was probably one of the most important things to our development as musicians. You know, it's obviously also the reason why we met in the first place. But definitely, you know, figuring out how to navigate making music and studying for tests and all that kind of stuff can be a challenge. But as long as you just keep sticking to it, keep your head down, you know, it gets easier over time, because you're going to get better at music, and it becomes like a second nature thing where you can, you know, be studying for something and go off and finish a record, and, you know, or go back to a record, whatever it may be. And me and Denzel's case, like, we were going to school for music, but, you know, there's times where our schedule started to become more free and we were able to put more time towards it and all that kind of stuff. So, but I think by going to school, it definitely allowed us to focus even harder on improving and also cherishing the moments that we were able to work on music. And in those moments, spending all our time to get better and better. So, you know, obviously me and Denzel are at different stages because we aren't in school and we don't have to worry about some of those other life things that are happening. But there's a lot of things from that period of my life that I think were so important that lived outside of just the making music part that added to our ability to making music in the first place. You know, just how to navigate through the world, you know, learning from, you know, a different subject or whatever it may be, applying that to the music creation. So if you can kind of, if music is the goal, music is the focus, if every single thing in your life, you can take it and then apply it back to the music that you're creating, even if you don't have the time to make a beat or, you know, record vocals, but you're always thinking about it, at the same time, getting your homework done and getting A's on tests and all that kind of stuff. But that's kind of how me and Denzel approached it, was always just thinking about the music and taking everything around us, learning from it, not just as musicians, but as adults, and like how to navigate through the music industry and interact with people. And then carving out that time and, you know, dedicating ourselves to getting better, like in that time. And, you know, as you're young, like live, you know, me and Denzel, like, you know, we would hang out with people. There'd be times that we wouldn't be, you know, working on music that much. We'd just be living, you know, we'd go to a party here or there. Like, we'd go out for a bite to eat here or there. And that's just things that you need normally in life to succeed, especially in music. Like, it's an art form that we create based off of our experiences, you know? So I think even in the times when you're not working on music right now, everything that you're going through just adds to your story, you know, adds to the things that you're going to eventually, you know, put on paper or like put in your songs. Everything is just, you know, it's a learning experience, and everything is an opportunity just to get better. So everything outside of music, you know, take it and run with it as well to apply it to the music.
If I can ask you one last thing, I don't want to take too much of your time, but I'm applying to NYU right now. I have the Steinhardt Music Business Program as my first choice, because I was a little worried that I might not be able to get into CDI. But if you could give it, like, I don't know, if you could give the Clive Davis Institute your best, like, recommendation or advertisement for it, what would you say about it?
In terms of like what we learned from Clive Davis?
Yeah.
A lot of things that I was just saying, I think the biggest thing is, me and Denzel didn't grow up directly in New York City. You know, we both come from pretty small farm towns, and college towns with just, you know, small populations of people. And I think an advantage that you guys have from the start is just being able to experience a major city in a major city where a lot of art is happening. And that's art outside of music as well. Like, you can step into a gallery and, you know, experience something new. You could, obviously not with COVID, but you can step into, you know, a movie theater that's playing something that's, you know, not, you know, in regular theaters, or go to like an off Broadway performance, all that kind of stuff. So I think those experiences that, just of the city, was a big thing. Like, that's, you know, just outside of Clive Davis in itself, just us being, you know, 18-year-olds, 19, 20, 21, you know, being adults for the first time, and, being on by ourselves and, you know, taking everything in. But I think Clive Davis, and we have a lot of friends that came from Steinhardt as well. You know, I can speak for our experience a little bit more, but just being able to sit down with, you know, teachers that are just focused in music and learning and being inspired from people that have dedicated their lives to music is a huge thing. Just finding yourself around, especially elders and mentors that think similar to you. I remember coming from Vermont, you know, I took jazz band, but that was kind of my only education within my school in music, you know, so coming to college and learning from mentors and teachers that I found myself looking up to, like, I learned so much, whether it was from, you know, working inside Logic or Pro Tools, or like learning the legal side of things and like reading contracts, or like, you know, going over music history with, you know, or like songwriting class, or like whatever it might be. I don't know too much about Steinhardt's course curriculum, but the people that I know there seem like they had similar experiences. Whether you end up at Steinhardt or end up at Clive, I think first and foremost is, you know, learning and living and creating in a city like New York, especially as an adult. And, you know, learning from mentors in that same city that think the same as you is a experience that I would never trade for the world. And learning all different types of things was major. If I was just an 18-year-old kid, like, not understanding like how to read a contract, my life might look completely different, you know? just because I might be in a situation that I never wanted to sign up for. I think, that those are some of the things that I learned from going to college. You know, myself and Denzel learned from going to college was just all the things outside of music creation that help to understand how to navigate the music world, and learn how to, you know, survive in it, really, like, be comfortable in it, and feel like it's a world for you. I think before NYU, I didn't really necessarily think music was totally a world for me. Like, I dreamt of it being a world for me. I think NYU and going to college helped me understand that it could be a world for me, and I understood how to navigate when I graduated. So,
and I would say the same with just, you know, obviously you don't need to go to any specific school or college to learn how to make music, because there's so many people that don't, but it's the, for us, it was the space, the spaces in between making music, which is majority of the space, is we're primarily fueled by the fact that we learned all these things in college and all these different skills, specifically in Clive. Like, you know, after we graduated, there was a huge gap of time before we were able to, like, you know, comfortably buy food without being nervous if we were going to have enough money for it, you know? So that time in between of learning, you know, this is how you balance a budget, this is how to do these, like, other side projects that will make us money, that'll allow us to survive till we get to that point that it's not necessarily the biggest thing on our mind anymore. Or even just now, we, like, you know, interfacing with labels and knowing how to present things in the right way, like, some of our biggest things that we've accomplished have been because we, you know, were able to present ourselves in a compelling way, whether it's, like, through writing something or just, like, actually speaking to people. So that was something that we wouldn't be able to do at this point if it wasn't for going to Clive. And I feel like, you know, like David was saying, in between Clive or Steinhardt or any of the other programs, I think, you know, it's all about what you want to take out of it. Obviously, no one remembers everything from college, but I think having, you know, the, you know, foresight to say, like, okay, these are the things I want to take along with me and pay attention to, and that will, like, help me going forward with what my intention of my life is the most important part. Because then you get to really, like, dive into the things that you need and be able to take those tools with you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And just one more thing too, I think through that experience, and then, you know, obviously working within the music industry and meeting artists, producers, songwriters, the one thing that I've seen when it comes to longevity in the music business as a creative is that every single one of them that are operating at that level are also great executives. So it's also more than just understanding how to create music. It's how to work within music and, you know, eventually reach a level where you're bringing people up and mentoring people and all those kind of things. But being able to interact with the lawyer, being able to interact with the A&R, and all those things play such a huge role, I think, in the success of, you know, young creatives and just, you know, the field that we're operating in. A lot of our peers and a lot of our friends are people that I would consider have mastered that, that understand how to work on both sides. So yeah, I think that's a gigantic thing, is just having, like, understanding and having the knowledge of how to work within the music industry, how to read contracts, how to communicate. And yeah, that's it.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah, of course. Of course.
I think that all that advice is incredible. And I do want to give a shout out to Steinhardt, because that is where I went. Clive Davis actually did not exist.
I didn't even know.
The Clive Davis School did not exist when I went to NYU. You know, it's an incredible program as well. So anyway, I can talk from my side of it as well, that, you know, it's valuable. And I think what these guys said about utilizing New York City and understanding, you know, what an incredible gift this city is. You know, I mean, this is where American culture started, like, in a lot of ways, in New York City. And the melting pot of New York City, you know, that type of melting pot can only happen once, because the cultures that came together in New York City for the first time after thousands of years of independent, you know, evolution, that can only happen once, right? Now we're all together. We have airplanes and we have, you know, smartphones, and it's never going to mix like that in the same way. So you know, just honor the city, and the city will be there for you, you know, and inspire you.
Yeah, I mean, I can't imagine going anywhere else. Like, this is the birthplace of hip hop, of punk music, of so many different genres. So, like, I really want to soak it up in college as much as possible.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So listen, guys, I think, you know, we're at a half hour over at this point. And I think, you know, you guys have provided so much excellent feedback and information for, you know, these young people. And we're really grateful. And also, the president and CEO of the Songwriters Hall of Fame happens to be on this Zoom call. And I believe she would like to say something as well. So why don't we give her a moment and then we'll finish up. Are you there, Linda?
Okay. I just want to say a couple of things. First of all, I'm glad I'm not an A&R because the music was phenomenal. Second of all, I can't believe that Denzel and David are 27 years old. You guys, we have a 20-year qualification for the Songwriters Hall of Fame, so you have a few more years. But I don't think you thought at this age you'd be nurturing the next generation of talent. I've spent my entire career in this business. I can't even tell you how many decades, but it starts with five. And I was an executive at Atlantic for a lot of years, 20 years, and then up at Warner Music Group, the first female executive. So everything that these guys have told you is so true. I'm sitting here being totally blown away. The first thing, what they're telling you is how you get out there and how you get your music out there. And the days of the A&R guys going to clubs, days of the managers who have the clout, that, those days are all gone with now. It's exactly what they were telling you how to get there. Get your thing, go to, you know, Justin Bieber was found on Facebook or whatever, Shawn Mendes, this is how you do it. Number two is it's definitely a job, like Denzel says. It's positively a job, and that's how you approach it. Number three is what David just said is exactly what I have been preaching for years and years and years to the people at the labels and stuff. If they were an A&R, and I'm talking about, we had Jason Flom, we had other kids like this, and I would say, you got to learn about how contracts are done. You got to learn the finance. You have to learn every angle. So not only should the songwriters and producers and creative people be learning, taking these business courses and really learning them, the athletes who are out there playing ball should be doing the same thing so that you don't get screwed with your contracts and with everything else. But before you can be successful creatively or as an executive, you need to understand the entire world you're living in, whether it's music or it's athletes or whatever. The last thing I want to say is the most important thing that is that you have to appreciate and love other genres of music if you want to be in music. You don't become an elitist. You don't become a snob. You're not an opera classical fan, so you hate hip hop or you hate pop. You're not a rapper, so you don't like pop or you don't like country. It doesn't work that way. Everything begins with a song. That's why we're the Songwriters Hall of Fame. A song starts from the heart and the soul. That's where it's born. You don't sit and say, I'm going to write a song today for rap. I'm going to write a song today for country. You just write it, and then you work on it from there. When we inducted Jay-Z, who was our first hip-hop rap inductee 4 years ago, we got a lot of flack. I got a lot of calls. I had the New York Times calling me. I had everybody else. I had writers saying, that's not songwriting. It's a disgrace and everything else. It is the way a generation expresses itself. That's songwriting. Our job is not to critique them, not to criticize them. It's to nurture and help develop them and let them express what's in their heart and souls. And I'll end on that. My husband was also a King of the Hill recording engineer for over 40 years at RCA BMG. So we're talking about Elvis Presley, David Bowie, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And Denzel, he was in the studio doing Elvis when his tech forgot to turn the tape machine on. And he had to cover up. A second time they were in the studio again with Elvis. And nobody knows this, by the way, this hasn't been in any books. And the second time they were complaining about the sound. And it was because one of his techs hadn't plugged one of the mics in.
Wow.
And Mike Mike worked with people like Bowie, and Bowie's thing was that everything had to be perfect. And every time he'd get to a different take, Mike would say, oh, it can't be any better than that. And it would be. But my husband, first of all, hates everybody with perfect pitch. And second of all, thinks that the first take is usually the best. Because that's kind of like a lot, again, of when you really come out with the vibe and you're really going and you're not trying to perfect it. Because music isn't perfection. So on that note, I don't know if I'll be around to induct you guys another 15 years, but I'll be your induction if you are. I may not be president chair by then. I'll be in a wheelchair or something, knock on wood. But we're very, very proud of this program and Harold and April from our Songwriters Hall of Fame, what you've created, and that we're able to help work with the high school level now and nurture them. And we're really, really so grateful and so honored to have David and Denzel, to have you participate in this and to represent us. And I hope we'll see you in future things. I hope we'll see you at our gala. We just announced it today, June 16th.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We'll be there. Yeah, I mean, this is a, you know, this is quite an honor for us at the end of the day. So thank you so much for having us and, you know, allowing us to have this opportunity to speak to some of these awesomely talented kids who, you know, I hope to hear a lot more from as well. So this is a great experience. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, we appreciate you bringing us into this. We're looking forward to doing more.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, guys. I have a quick thank you reel that I would like to play. If you'd like to stay on the line, stay on the call. We're going to play the reel. I'm going to cut the feed to YouTube, and then we can chat for a couple minutes if you'd like, or if you have somewhere to go, that's all good. But let me just go ahead and play this last piece to say thank you for everybody involved, including Universal Music Group, for really their incredible partnership in putting this together. Today's Songwriters Hall of Fame Master Sessions at Stuyvesant High School would not have been possible without the talent, foresight, wisdom, and outreach of dedicated members of the Songwriters Hall of Fame New York Education Committee. I would like to personally thank Linda Moran, President and CEO of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, April Anderson, Marketing and Communications Director of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, Francesca McAuliffe, AP of World Languages, Art, and Music here at Stuyvesant High School, as well as Sing You, our principal, for their support and encouragement in putting today's event together. A big shout out to Simone Dixon, David Gray, Ari Geloff, and Kaylee Smith from Universal Music Publishing Group, Shira Gons from the Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment, and last but not least, Liz Guglielmo, Callie McGlone, and Robert Lamont from the Office of Arts and Special Projects. Keep up the amazing work. Stay healthy, everyone, and keep the faith. Until